In today's class, we'll be discussing three different topics: personal and team software process model, that is PSP and TSP, process technology, product and process. Now coming on to the first topic, PSP and TSP. Now why do we require PSP and TSP? Now we are living in a world that is governed by technology. Each and everything, each and every software or each and every area of expertise require a particular software for running their business. It might be any type of business. It can be a government. It can be military systems. It can be education systems. Everything requires a software. Now when you are dealing with software, it is very necessary that the software that you're building, the people that are building your software, they are very efficient in building the particular software. And as the world is governed by technology, the cost schedule and the quality of the software is the most critical concern that need to be kept in mind while developing the business. That is, the software that you're developing, it should not be a very high cost software that you're developing. And the quality of the software should be very well. Now, the quality of the software should be very good, because in here, if suppose you develop a particular software that is going to compromise your security, or it is going to crash if there is a lot of load upon the system, then there is no use for you for developing a particular software. That is why it is very well. It should be ensured that the quality of the software is very well defined. Now, as many areas require softwares, but many projects also fail. Now, why do these projects fail? Now, many times the project fail because the project commitments are often unrealistic. Now, what do you mean by unrealistic? Unrealistic means something that cannot be achieved is unrealistic. If suppose a particular end user is going to come and tell you that they want a software to be developed within a week's time. But practically speaking, if suppose that particular software requires a month time or 3 months time, if suppose it requires 3 months of time, and you're just guaranteeing them that you might be able to complete the software within 1 week of time. So that is an unrealistic approach. Many projects fail because you have a particular approach that is unrealistic. It does not meet the real world scenario. The next one is larger projects are harder to control. Now in here, larger project means you're going to have more number of people, more number of components. A lot of manpower is required to develop a particular project. Now one person is unable to handle this entire work project. That is why it becomes harder to control. Now in here, within control, you're going to identify, like, each and everything is going to come in here. Within control, the quality is going to come. The work product that you're developing, that is going to come in here. That is the quality, work product, the different teams that are working on, the quality of the different components, how you're coding, how you're testing. Each of these becomes very hard to control. That is, who is developing the software, who is falling out of the schedule, who is taking a lot of time, or how many bugs are there, how do you need to remove the bugs. It becomes very difficult to track them. The third one is quality problems get worse with project size. As within the previous point, I've discussed that when a project is very hard, people focus on completing the project within time. They compromise the quality. So that is a major concern in project failure. Now, to be effective, team needs leadership and coaching. Now, in here, now as projects become harder to be managed, you need a leader that is going to coach the entire team. How many multiple teams are there? They need to be assisted by a manager that is going to train them, who's going to motivate them to meet the quality of the work product. The next is need for change. Now, as we have discussed that many lives, they depend on a particular software. Let that be a medical field, education field, everything depends on a particular software. Now, if suppose within a medical field, you're developing a particular software that is going to track a person's pulse. The pulse of the person is very important. If suppose that software fails and he's unable to detect the pulse of a particular person, of an ill patient, then it is going to affect his life. The doctors might not be able to save him because they did not get to know within the first place that his pulse wasn't working. The next is we need complex and safer systems that is going to deliver you projects within a particular specified time. Now in here, the two requirements in here, these can be fulfilled by TSP. Now, what is TSP? It is Team Software Process. Now, as by the name, T stands for Team Software Process, means you're going to have multiple members within a project team. Now, multiple members within a project team, it can vary from 3 members to 20 members. Now, this team process model, they are going to ensure that the software that they are developing, it is going to be the best quality software, because these are self-directed teams. Now, what do you mean by self-directed teams? Self-directed team means they do not need a leader. They form what are the requirements that you need. They are going to plan the schedule. They are going to identify the risks. They are going to remove the risk. Everything will be managed by team software process, because they are working within as a team. The next is PSP. PSP stands for Personal Software Process. Now, by the name itself, PSP means personal software process. Personal means one particular individual. It is going to focus on one particular individual. Now, suppose this particular individual, he is a software engineer. You're going to focus on this particular software engineer, that he acquires minimum level of knowledge and skills to work on a project. He has the knowledge and skills to work efficiently on the project. So the TSP and PSP are going to help you achieve this change of software. Now, coming on to PSP, we are going to study PSP in detail in here. Now, PSP is going to have an emphasis on estimate and plan your work. Now, as I told you, now this personal software process model, this was developed by the person named Watts Humphrey. PSP was designed by Watts Humphrey. Now, in here, Watts Humphrey told that when each and every individual, that we can say that each and every software engineer, if he is well trained, it becomes easy for the organization as well for the entire team to achieve very good results. So in here, PSP is going to focus on estimate and plan your work. That is, in here, you're going to train one particular individual at a particular time. So in here, he'll be given a particular project. Now, for that particular project, he needs to make his own plan. He need to identify what are the resources that are required. Then he is going to identify what might be the risks. Then how is he going to remove those risks? Each and everything, and how you're going to assure a best quality software. Each of the things, these all are performed by one individual. Now, when one person is given a particular project, he needs to handle each and everything, the planning, resources, the risk, the quality, then he becomes well trained within each and every concept. Now, and here the next is meet your commitments. Now, what is a commitment? That you are going to develop the particular software within a month of time. So in here, you need to stick to your commitment. That is, you need to be on schedule. You need to be on schedule. Now, what you're telling, your word should be final. If you're telling that it will be completed within a month time, then it should be completed within a month time. The next is measurement of work product and resultant quality. Now, within the previous slide, we've discussed that this is one of the major problems that projects fail. Now, in here, project fail because the work product, what is work product? Work product is the end product that is being developed, the software. The documentation, or report, these are your work products for your end product. So in here, this document and report, they are not up to the mark. They do not have all the specifications, and the quality of the software is not there. That is, it achieves low level of quality. So in here, PSP is going to focus on these three main criteria that is going to train the individual so that he can best perform on the software that he'll be working within the future. Now in here, within PSP, the software engineer also understands your current performance. Now in here, when you're working on a particular software, you know what is your ability, how much you can achieve. That can be identified. Then the next is be better equipped to improve capability. Now, when one person is working on one particular project, he knows what is his ability, how he can achieve. He gets to know what he is capable of. When he knows what he is capable of, he can improve his performance by making use of different tools and different techniques for completing the particular project. So PSP focuses on a software engineer's personal development. Now, PSP is a process that allows a software engineer to produce a high quality product on time and within a budget. Now, in here, whenever you're developing a particular software, it is very important that if you're giving some time to the end user, that time should be met. You need to guarantee the software will be developed on time. Now, in here, whenever you're designing the particular software, the end user is going to tell you the different set of requirements. Now, based upon the requirements, you're going to give him an estimated cost. An estimated cost is going to be there. Now you need to guarantee that the software that you're developing, it should be within this particular cost only. It should be within the budget. You're not going to tell them that you need to pay upfront so and so amount, then only you'll be given the software. So that is unrealistic. The next point is PSP shows engineer how to manage the quality of the project. What are the different, you're going to learn in here, what are the different quality standards and how you're going to meet this quality standards. What are the quality standards and how you're going to meet these quality standards? It will be taught to the particular software engineer. Making commitments that they can meet, we've already seen this, then improve estimating and planning. Now, when a particular individual is given a particular project that he needs to work on, now within the first phase, he might not be able to make the exact estimate. Exact estimate becomes impossible for him to identify that. So in here, you're going to focus on how you're going to improve the estimation and how you're going to make a plan. Now, what does planning require? Planning means making a particular schedule, how you're going to work on, identifying the different risks that might occur, and identifying the different resources that will be required. Resources means it can be different technology, it can be the number of people that need to work on. These are the different resources. And within the plan, you're also going to identify the different work tasks that will be performed to achieve a work product. Then the last one is reduce defect in their products. Now in here, as you're completely working on a particular software, you know what types of errors might occur, what might lead to a particular error. Now in here, when you know what is causing a particular error, you can focus on reducing the defect for the particular product. You're training a particular individual in every aspect for developing a particular software. Coming on to the PSP framework activities. Now within this PSP framework, there are five framework activities within the personal software development. Now within the planning phase, what you're going to do is, now within the first phase, you've got all the requirements. To make a plan, you're going to have a requirement. Now what you're going to do is, you are going to isolate these requirements. That is, these requirements are not going to change. Now when your requirements are isolated, what you're going to do is, you're going to identify the resources that will be required. Now, as in the previous slide, I've told you, what does planning encompass? The resources that are required, the risks that might occur. Now, within risk, you can say what are the different defects that might occur also. Making a schedule and identifying the work products and work tasks that need to be followed. That is the planning phase. Now within the planning phase, what you're also going to do is, you're going to identify what are the different development tasks that you need to do. Development means when you're developing a particular software, you're making the design. You're just going to define the task that will be followed. That is the first phase. The next phase is high level design. Now, within this high level design, you're going to identify what are the different components that are going to be used within the particular software. Now, when you know the different components that you're going to use, you're going to develop a prototype. Now, you might remember, what is a prototype? A prototype is a model. You're going to make a model so that you can identify whether all the requirements are that were specified by the end user, whether all of them are embedded within the model or not. Within the high level design, you're going to identify the different components that the software is going to encompass of. Then based on that, you're going to make a model. Then you're going to identify the external specifications. Now, what are the external specifications? Now, for a specific components within a particular software, how you're going to connect them is going to be identified. Now, connecting them outside the system. Now, if suppose internal specification means how you're going to connect it to the network, that is internal specification. Whereas external specification is how you're going to connect it via, you're going to use a plug and socket to connect. That is an external specification. Now, within the high level design, you're also going to identify and you're going to record all the issues. All the issues are going to be recorded and tracked. Now in here, it is necessary that you are going to record all these issues, because when you have in written format that these are the different issues that are occurring within the particular software, it becomes easy for you to remove those issues. Tracking means if suppose one issue is being resolved, you're going to remove it from the list. The next is high level design review. Now as high level design review, you have this additional word that is review in here. Now within this high level design review, what you're going to do is you're going to make use of formal methods for verification are going to be used in here. Now if you remember, we have studied a model, formal methods model. Now within this formal methods model, what did we use? We have used different mathematical notations or mathematical formulas so that you can identify the performance of a particular software that you're developing. The performance, the accuracy, by making use of formal mathematical notations, it becomes easy for you to analyze what is the performance that is being achieved. If you're telling that it is achieving 92.1%, how you're going to prove that it is achieving 92.1% of accuracy or 100% performance is there? So you're going to make use of this formal methods verification for that as a review standard that is used. Apart from that, now these formal methods verification model, it is also used to uncover errors. Now in here, as you're using a mathematical formula, this is going to be very precise. Now in here, by making use of mathematical notations, it becomes easy for you to uncover errors that sometimes might go that sometimes a software engineer might neglect it. That is why you're going to use a mathematical formula so that you can uncover those errors. Then you're going to maintain metrics for all the tasks that are being produced. Now, what is metrics? Now, metrics in here, metrics can be stated as a standard measure. Now, for quality, you're going to have different level of standards. For performance, there are different standards. So in here, for every task that you're performing, you're going to achieve the metric. That is the best possible way, or the best, you can say that you're achieving the best standard. You're meeting the best standard. The best criteria is being achieved. You're delivering the best standard. That is high level design review. The next is development. Now in here, within high level design, we have seen that you're going to identify the different components that are available. So these components are going to be taken and you're going to start the design. By making use of the components, you're going to start with the designing part. Now when you're designing, you're going to review each and every component that you're using and each and every work task that is being produced. Each and everything you're going to keep an eye on. Then next thing is, first you're going to start designing with the components. The second one is you're going to start coding. You're going to generate the code and you're going to compile it and then test the code. Again, in here, you're going to maintain the metrics, the same part you're going to maintain metrics. Now in here, for each and every process, why are we maintaining metrics? Because in here, personal software development, it focuses on delivering a high quality software. That is why you, within each phase, you're going to maintain the metrics. You're going to keep track of whether each and every phase, each and every step that you're following, whether it achieves the best level attributes associated for a particular code or for a particular component. Then the last framework activity is postmortem, not the one of the science field, but in here, this postmortem, this is going to focus on improving the efficiency of the particular product. Now in here, suppose you have designed a software that has achieving some 91% of performance. How you're going to improve them? You might try to push it to 98% or 99%. How you're going to improve that? Those all different steps are going to be followed. Now this efficiency is improved by following all the measurement and metrics that you have followed within the previous steps. That is why you're keeping a record of all the measurement and metrics in here. By making use of all the measurement and metrics, you're going to identify whether the software you're developing, whether it is effective or not. Then based on that, you're going to improve the efficiency of the particular product. So these are the five framework activities for PSP. Now coming on to the final statement for PSP. Now this PSP, this was designed for individual use, that is training one particular person at a time. You can say one software engineer. For multiple people, you've got the PSP. So PSP was designed for individual use. The second one, it helps a software engineer to identify the errors and remove them. Now, when you identify the different types of errors, and you are also going to identify now a particular person. Now, while compiling a Java program or while compiling a C program, you identify that sometimes you make the same mistake again and again. The same way in here, you're going to identify what are the same mistakes that you're likely to make. The errors that you're likely to make. Missing the semicolons or not giving brackets, you're opening the bracket but not closing it. If that is the same errors that you're making, you can try and fix them. Now in here, this PSP software process, this is a challenging process and it demands commitment. That is, you just can start with the training and you just cannot leave it. You need to stick with it. It demands commitment and it is challenging because you are trained in every aspect. You might get frustrated. You might want to leave it. But in here, when you focus on each and every aspect, when you learn, it is good for yourself. And the last part is, now in here, for this PSP requires a certain level of training. Now these trainings can be lengthy. Now, these trainings can be lengthy based upon how you're identifying errors, whether you are able to correct the errors that you're making. If suppose the same mistakes that you're doing it again and again, then it is going to take a lot of time. Then those PSP software projects are a bit costly. There's the final statement on PSP. It is designed for individual use. A particular individual will be focusing on identifying the different errors. Now these errors are going to be added so that he is able to pick these errors early, and then the errors that he makes, you're going to identify those and try and fix them. Then this PSP is challenging because it requires certain level of commitment. Then PSP trainings are lengthy and costly. The next software process model is team software process. Now this team software process, now with the personal software process model, it was developed by Watts Humphrey. Now this same person has extended the lessons that were learned from PSP. That is, each and every individual is being trained at a certain level that he's able to recognize the different errors. Now if suppose a requirement comes that you need to develop a particular software that is lengthy, huge, bulky software. So in here it is going to require not only one person to work on, but it requires multiple people to work on. That is a team. You require a team that is going to work on. So in here, it is necessary that this team, the persons that are working within the team, they are well-defined. They know what they are doing. So the goal of this TSP is to build self-directed project team. That is, you do not need to come and guide them. You need to do this. You need to do that like a small journey. They are going to direct themselves what needs to be done within a software project. So these are self-directed teams, and they are going to produce a high-quality software. TSP along with PSP. Now, in here, if suppose a particular persons that are working within a team, each and every person was trained by PSP, by personal software process. So in here, when you're using this TSP along with PSP, it is going to just boost up your performance. It is going to give you high performance to each and every individual, because in here they're trained as a team and they are also trained as an individual. So there are two types of training. So it is going to boost up the performance of the software engineer. Now this TSP software process model, they are going to ensure quality software products. Now you might be wondering, within personal software process also it focused on quality software process. But again in TSP, it is again focusing on the quality of the software product. Why? Because in here, if suppose one particular person is trained to ensure the quality, it is necessary that the entire team that they're working on the different components, each and everyone focuses upon the quality of the software product. Because if this quality of the software product is low, then there is no use for you to develop the software product. If suppose there's a competitive product that is launched within the market within the same few days, then people are not going to go for your product. They are going to go for the another set of product that has got the best quality. The next is create secure software products. The software that you're developing, it should be secure. Now, it should not be that you're installing a particular software and it is going to spread some virus within your system, or it is going to track all your personal information and it is going to not keep it encrypted, but it is just posting it online somewhere. So it is necessary that each and every software process that you're using, it should be secure. Then improve the process management in an organization. Now in here, the process management, now in here, people are not working at individual level, they are working at team level. Team level work is in here. So in here, when a particular team is performing well, so in here it is going to improve the entire reputation of the organization or the entire process that is followed within an organization. Now, as TSPs are, as we have mentioned, that TSP are self-directed team. Now, this self-directed teams, they are going to set its own goal. That is, the manager is not going to come and tell you that this is the goal that you need to achieve. They are going to set their own goal, establish its own role. That is, in here, within a software team, who is going to do what job, that will be identified. Like, who does what is identified. There's not a person assigned that is going to tell you need to follow this, you need to follow this. That is not the case. Decides on its own development strategy. That is how you're going to develop the software, whether it is component-based development, whether you're following a spiral model technique, that strategy will be decided on their own. What model you're using or what framework activities you're using, that will be identified. What models are used or what framework activities are followed. The next is, it defines its own process. That is, what are the steps that you're following that will be ensured. The next is, it develops its own plan. Now, in here, as you have set your own goal, you've identified what is the role of each and every person, you're going to make your own schedule, how you're going to work on. A schedule is being designed. Then measure, manage and control its own work. That is, again in here, each and every task is done by them. Now in here, within this entire team, they are themselves going to measure their work, whether they are following the schedule, whether the software that they are developing, whether it has all the requirements stated by the end user. And controlling means, if suppose certain bugs might occur within the software or errors, how you're resolving them, that will be identified. Each of this all tasks are done by the team itself. Now, self-directed teams do the best work. Now, in here, if suppose there is a team within an organization that is doing their own work, identifying their own strategy, everything, and at the end, you're giving them the best project. So, in here, there will be no issue with the management also. Like, the managers are also going to support them until and unless you deliver them with the best project. There is not going to be any issue with the organization or the management. Now, there are a few objectives of TSP. Now, an objective of TSP is within this team software process model, a team is going to encompass of 3 or 20 engineers, not less than this, not more than that. You're going to have a fixed ratio of a fixed number of 3 to 20 engineers. The next one are, now in here, managers are going to coach and motivate team and help sustain peak performance. Now, you might be wondering that within the previous slide, I have told you that each and every work is done by the individual. But in here, there is going to be a manager that is going to motivate the team and help sustain peak performance. That is in here, within a particular month, a particular company has got many projects. So in here, you need to do simultaneous work or you need to finish the first project that was given to you early. You need to speed up your work so that you can work on the next project. So in here, the manager is going to help you to motivate so that you need to achieve the peak performance. You need to do your best. Now, if you do your best, you might also get an increment, or there are some, like they're even paying you for long working hours. That might be a scenario where managers are going to motivate you to sustain the peak performance. The next is the software process improvement by making CMM level 5 behavior normal and expected. Now, within the capability maturity model, we have studied there are different levels within this model. The level 5 was optimization. Now, what is optimization? Optimization is you're going to provide updates so that your particular software that was built, it works more better, or you're going to embed a few more features within the software with each update. So in here, you're going to boost up the software improvement by making this CMM level 5 behavior normal and expected. That is in here, the managers or the team members, they are going to identify and tell you that if suppose the software is being developed, you're not just going to just put it in, you're just not going to put it aside and just wonder that this for the software, you don't need to do any more work. Whereas the manager is going to tell you that making updates within a particular software that you are developing, it is normal and it is expected. You need to expect that the end user is anyhow going to come and tell you that then you require a particular update for the software. Some more features are likely to be added within the software. So this behavior needs to be normal and expected. Now, if suppose within the first step only, you're going to tell you that this, you might also need to work on the software within the upcoming days. So in here, you are prepared for this type of scenario. You're not just going to panic. The next object is provide improvement guidance to high maturity organizations. Now, within the CMMI model, we have studied that each and every organization, they achieves a certain level of maturity. Level 1, level 2, level 3, 4, and 5. So in here, you're going to improve the guidance. That is, each and every organization, if it is at level 1, that particular organization needs to be gone up to level 2 or 3. So that each and every organization should achieve the level 5 maturity standard. The next one is, now in here, you need to provide facilities for teaching university students for industrial grade team skills. That is at university level only. If the students are being taught that this are the different techniques that need to be followed for personal training, for team training, if this are embedded within the university teaching only, then it becomes easy for the multinational companies to train the users, that they only need to train them for working on a particular software. Whereas the team skills and personal skills, they are already embedded within the student at the university level, like when he was pursuing his education. The next is TSP framework activities. Now, within this TSP framework activities, the five activities are launch, high level design, implementation, integration and test, postmortem. Now the first one is launch. Now within launch, launch is how you're going to start your particular project. The next, next is high level design. Now this launch I'll be discussing in detail within the next slide. Now high level design, we identified that what are the different components that will be used within a software. Based on that, you're going to develop a prototype, a model. You're going to identify the external specifications, how you're going to connect the software, and any issues are going to be tracked and you're going to keep a track of them. Within implementation, you're going to do the coding part, implementing the code. That is, you're going to embed all the features within the software by coding. Now in here, for each and every component and for each and every coding part, what you're going to do, you're going to integrate the different components, the different features within the software, so that you form one particular model. That is, each and everything is embedded within the software. Then you're going to test this. Now this is called as comprehensive testing. What is comprehensive testing? Testing the entire software altogether with all the different components. You're going to provide with comprehensive testing. After that, postmortem. We have seen that postmortem is going to set the stage for process improvement. Now, TSP makes use of scripts, forms that serve as standard in the work. That is, whatever you're doing, you're going to make use of any type of scripts or any type of forms are going to be used while you're working on TSP. Now, each project is launched using a sequence of steps that enable the team to establish a solid basis for starting the project. Now, in here, launching means how you're going to start the particular project. That you're launching a particular software. In here, you're going to launch it by following a sequence of steps. Now, we'll see what are those different steps. Now, these are the different steps that need to be followed. The first one is review the project objectives with management and agree on team goals. Now, in here, review the project objective means what you're developing that need to be shown to the management so that the management agrees. Now, in here, you're going to have the first sign, that is, first the end user is going to tell you that what needs to be developed. You're going to have signatures of end users, whereas to start the project, you're going to have signatures of the manager. That is, in here, if you have both of them, you get a head start to start the particular software. Then establish team roles. Who is going to do what job? That will be identified. The next one is define team development process. Now, team development process means within an entire team. Now, as this team can encompass of 3 to 20 members, within this, in here, how you're going to develop each and every component, how much time it is going to tell you, how much time it is going to take you, what are the different tasks that you're following, and what is the steps that you're following or the activities that you're following, that will be identified. The next is make a quality plan and set quality standards. In here, you're just first, within the first stage, you're just going to make a plan. That is, this is how we are going to achieve the quality. And target is, if suppose the previous project that you've met, it has a quality standard of level 2. So in here, you're going to set a standard for level 1 quality. The next is plan needed to support facilities. That is, in here, you're going to identify what are the different resources that are required, what are the different tools, the different technology that you will be using, that all will be identified. The next is produce overall development strategy. Now in here, within this, within the third step, we have seen that you're developing a process that is for each, what are the different tasks that you will be following, that you're taking in here. But in here, all the steps are taken for the overall project. Within the overall project, how you're going to achieve the completion of the particular project. You're going to consider the overall project. The next is develop a plan for entire project. When you have a particular development strategy, you're going to make a schedule for the entire project. That is how much time will be taken for coding, how much time will be taken for testing, for modeling, design, for developing prototypes, for each and every aspect, you're going to make a schedule. Then the next is development plan for each engineer for next phase. Now in here, you've made a plan for this within the sixth and seventh step. We have developed a plan for the entire project in here. Within sixth and seventh, this is done for the overall project. Whereas in here, within the eighth step, you're going to make a development plan for each engineer at the next phase. That is, a particular project might have five or six phases. Different phases are there. 5 to 6 phases are there. For each and every phase, if suppose a particular person is currently working on fifth, then you're going to plan ahead what you're going to do within the sixth phase. You're going to plan ahead for each and every phase. This will be done for each and every software individual. Then the ninth one is merge individual plans into team plans. Now in here, within the eighth step, what we've seen is that you're making a plan for each and every engineer. Now in here, when each and every person is able to complete his plan, well, that each and every one has completed its task, when the task is being completed or the components are designed, you're going to assemble all of these components together. You're going to merge these individual plans into team plans. Each of them, that is one person is developing like this. Within a team, if suppose there are five members, five within this, in here, two might be working on one component and the other three might be working on other components. So you're going to combine this 3+2 and make it into a team plan. That is, these five members are going to complete one particular task or one particular component is going to be completed by these number of people. That will be identified in here and the plan is made for the team. The 10th one is rebalance team work plan into a team plan. That is, in here, sometimes what happens is a particular person might get a lot of workload. He might get a lot of workload. So in here, you're going to rebalance this team workload plan into a team plan. That is, in here, a particular software might have more than two teams or more than one team or more than two teams. Based upon that, if suppose one particular team was able to complete their defined task within a specific time and another team has got a lot of work and it requires a lot of time and a lot of resources and a lot of manpower, then again, you're going to reassign, you can rebalance this by sharing the workload. So that the team finishes a job on time and the team works efficiently. The 11th is assess project risks and assign tracking responsibility for each key risk. Now in here, there might be many problems that might arise within a particular project. So in here, you're going to keep track of each of the risks. That is, this risk might occur, how you're going to remove that. For each and everything, you're going to keep a track, whether it is removed or not. This needs to be maintained for each and every key risk. Key risk means like the main risk that might occur within a particular software. These main risks are going to be, so that you can, for this main key risk, you're going to keep a track so that you can remove these risks and so that they do not affect your software. So these are the different steps that are followed within the launch of the particular project. Now within this launch activity can be applied prior to each framework activity. That is, in here, this entire activities, this all 11 tasks, this need to be applied prior to each framework activity. How many framework activities we have studied? 5 framework activities. Before each of this framework activity, you can make use of this 11 tasks. Now coming on to the final statement of TSP. Now in here, we know that the best software teams are self-directed. That is, each and every person within the team, they are going to make a plan of their own, identify the risks of their own, make the best quality software, identify the different quality attributes. These are all self-directed teams. Then the next one is, this provides a distinct and a quantifiable benefit in production of software. Benefit for production of the software and its quality. Because you're going to achieve the best quality, you're going to identify what is the best process that might suit this particular software and what are the tasks that you need to follow so that you can develop a work product. You get the benefit of making a very good quality software. Then now in here within PSP, we have seen that each and every person needs to go undergo training. Now in here also, this entire team must undergo training. So that they get all these characteristics embedded within them and they can best apply them based upon the software. And we've also studied the 5 framework activities. The framework activities were launch, high level design. Within the launch, we have studied 11 points that you need to follow that can be applied prior to each framework activity. High level design, the different components that are going to be there, you're going to identify them. Any risks are there that you're going to identify, and any external interfaces. Then implementation. With an implementation, what you're going to do? You're going to go for the coding part, add all the features or assemble the different components or make a design within the implementation phase. Then the fourth one is integration and testing. Now within the second phase, we have identified the different components that will be required for making the software. So in here, you're going to assemble all of the software and then you're going to do a comprehensive testing. Then the fifth one is postmortem. Within postmortem, it focuses on the product improvement. So this is PSP and TSP. Now the next topic that we'll be studying is process technology. Now in here, the process technology means what are the different tools that you're using while developing a particular software. Now this process technology tools, they've been developed to help the software organization analyze the few things, the current process. Now if you have a particular software, now in here, there are different processes that are there within the software. You are going to identify what is the current process, that is the one that you're currently working on. That can be identified. Now this can be used by the manager because the team members, they already know on which particular process you're currently working on. The next one is organize the work tasks. Now in organizing the work tasks, now in your work task means the different activities that you're going to do within the particular software. So in here, if suppose you've got a software that is going to help you organize these activities that within, if suppose within one task, you've got one task, within this one task, you need to follow some subtasks. If all of them is well documented and you can keep a good track of them, so it is very efficient for the organization and the software team members. The next is control and monitor progress. Now, if suppose when everyone is doing the job at the end of the day or at the end of the work, everyone is going to update what they have done, update the work that they have done. So it becomes easy for you if they are updating the works and the errors that they have encountered. If suppose there are any more risks that might affect the particular software, if everything is documented in here, if everything is kept a track of, then it becomes easy for you to control that, as if any changes are there within the software, it becomes easy for you. And monitor progress, that is what is being done, that can be monitored whether you're following the schedule or not. The next is managing the technical quality. Now, in within the previous slides, you studied that within the different framework activities, you're going to keep track of the different metrics. What is metrics? Metrics is a standard measurement that you're going to use to measure the quality. If you have a track of all this measurement, which you're following and what software, what is the end product that you're getting, it becomes easy for you to enhance the particular software or improve the performance of the particular software. That is process technology. Now within this, you've got a clear idea of what is process technology. Now within this process technology, it can also be used by a particular organization so that you are creating an automated model. Now, if suppose there's a particular machine, when you are giving certain set of input, that are these are the different requirements that need to be there within a particular software. If you embed it, it might give you a prototype, representation of a prototype, that how this might look like, a 3D model. It can be a 3D model or it can be a graphical representation. If you have this automated model, it becomes easy for you to put in the requirements and you can get a image of how your model is going to look like. Now this automated model, it can be used for common process framework. Now in here, we have studied within the process framework activities, there are different umbrella activities. Within process framework, we have studied there are different umbrella activities that will be followed. There are different work tasks that need to be followed. Then different work products are developed. Then you also have a software process. What is that you're following? It becomes easy for you to keep a track of them. Then the next is task sets. Now within task sets, you identify what are the different activities that you're going to do to develop a particular software activities, or you can say the process that you're following, the steps that you're following, the sequence that you're following, that will be identified. Whereas the next is within the umbrella activities, you can take the different umbrella activities. Now within the umbrella activities, we've studied the different set of umbrella activities that can be followed. Now in here, you've got a set of 7-8 umbrella activities. Which umbrella activity is being followed, you can keep a track by making use of process technology. Now coming on to the last part, the last topic, that is product and process. Now in here, what is the difference between a product and a process? Now product, we can tell that what is product? Product is an end product. Now this end product, it can be any software that you're developing. It can be any tool. That is at the end, what end user is going to use. End user is going to use is your product, that whatever you are developing, that is being developed. That is called as your product. Whereas the next one is process. Now what is process? Now process is a sequence of steps that may be followed to create a project. That is what are the different tasks that you're doing or the different activities that you're following. What are the different, what is the job that you're doing that is going to result in the development of the product. The different steps that you're following, that is your process. The main purpose of process is to improve the quality. Process is going to focus on improving the quality of the particular project. Now in here, if the process that you're following, if the process is weak, the product is going to suffer. That is, if you are not following the best tasks that are needed to develop a particular software, then the product that you're going to develop, that is not going to have the best quality. So if you have a weak process, the product that you have developed, it is also going to be weak. But if you're just completely relying on the entire process only, that is, you're just focusing on the process should be the best. So that is also dangerous, because you need to have keep a good eye on the both things, with the process as well as the product. This is the end of the class.